So welcome to our worship this morning. It's great that we're all here. And as you will know that today we are not only thinking about the transfiguration of Jesus and thinking about a mountaintop experience, maybe having a chance to get a fresh perspective on what has been before us, gone before us, and what is still ahead of us. And in that spirit, we will be reflecting on the life of the church over this last year, as this is also our, technically it's our AGM. We are leaving all the businessy bits where we have to agree certain documents and things like that. We're leaving that all until after the final blessing. So I would encourage anybody who considers Chudley Baptist Church to be their church family, they consider themselves to be members, please would you stay on after the blessing at the end, so that we can together do those things that need to be done to do things in a right and proper way for the AGM. But those bits will be done at the end. But the whole spirit of an AGM should be an annual general meeting, an annual time to stop and reflect. And there's no better way than doing that than in the presence of the Spirit of God. Praying that he will reveal to us and remind us of things that have happened in the last 12 months that we need to remember, we need to give thanks for, some things that perhaps we need to grieve over. But that our prayer is that we'll be led by the Spirit of God this morning as we reflect on the year gone by, and also have our eyes open to what he might want for us in the year to come. So it's in that spirit that we're sort of designating this Sunday as our AGM, but that's because we want to look back in with his guidance and use that to lead us into worship and thanksgiving and confession and intercession and all those other things. So that's where we're going to today. This morning, it's been a long time since we had sort of shout out questions, but we're going to have a song in a moment, a song of praise and thanks, but I would love it if you were able during this song to message Anna. She should be fairly towards the top of the list when you look at your chat box, the list of names. Anna will be at the top because it's in alphabetical order. And if there is even just one thing, a word, a sentence, or perhaps something longer that you want to share, please write that in the chat to Anna. We're looking for answers to these questions. What are you thankful for today? What is it you have to praise God about today? And if we can do that while this song of praise is happening, that would be great. Please message Anna, and then Anna will gather all of those thoughts and prayers up into a time of prayer at the end of the song. So please do use this time to start expressing and to focus on what you have to be thankful for, what there is to praise God about today. So we're going to have the song Great Are You Lord, and that very much is based on the verse from Psalm 150 that says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And folks, that's all of us. Let us all praise the Lord. So we'll have that song. Please do put messages in the chat to Anna so that we can share and pray those prayers of thanks and praise at the end of the song. Thanks, Gareth.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. You give life, you are love. Darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. Yes, all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you,
everybody. There is such a lovely, lovely long list of things to praise God for, and to give thanks to God. And I'm very aware that some of us find that really difficult day, and some of us finding it a fantastic day. And I'm really glad we've got so much to praise God for, and for those that are finding it difficult, that we can stand with them and praise God even though they're finding it difficult, because I know I've been in a place where it's been difficult, not necessarily today. And this is just fabulous. I'm just really excited by this list. So let's just pray and praise God, and I'll run through. I won't say who said what, because there's just too many, which is a great thing to have. So let's just praise God together. Father, firstly, thank you for our families. Thank you. We've got people around us. We are so appreciative of that just now, when it's so difficult to see some of those family members. But we thank you, friends and family around us. We thank you, Lord God, that today we especially remember the hope and salvation you bring. We can look out of the window and see signs of spring, signs of new life, signs that you are still sustaining your creation. You are still the Lord of your creation. Father, during this pandemic, we have experienced extremes. And we thank you that in that you have been constant and you have provided for us. Father, thank you that we live in Devon, or some of us do anyway. I know not all of us here live in Devon, but thank you that we can get out easily just here in this vicinity and see beautiful landscapes, a beautiful place to live, that as we go and do some exercise that we're allowed to do, it brings joy to our hearts. Father, thank you that again on a Sunday, maybe we're a bit more aware of the rest of the week, that we remember that you are the provider of rest, restoration and resurrection life. We thank you that we're not part of just this people that we see here. We're people of a worldwide family of people who serve you. And Father, We thank you that many of us have work and some of us really, really love the work we do. Thank you that you provide us with a means of providing for those, for ourselves and those who we, with whom we live. It was a big change this week for many of us, and for one family in particular, they are grateful for a smooth return to school this week. It went smoothly and safely, so we thank you for that. And Father, as ever, we are grateful for our NHS service. We are grateful for the researchers in this country, the medical experts who have been guiding us through and advising us. And there is now a vaccine programme that is having an impact on this country. And that is making us a little bit, it's giving us a glimmer of hope just now. And lastly, we do thank you for those of us who've shown us so much love. We especially think of mums, and some of us have been privileged to have a very special mum in our lives who's shown us so much love. And we think of those who are finding this difficult, and we ask that you would really reveal your love to them and bring comfort. And we stand with them this morning. And Father, for all those things that we haven't shared this morning, we thank you that you are a great God who doesn't stop Sunday evening, but keeps going with us on Monday morning, Tuesday morning, and so on. And I'm sure there are many more things we are grateful for that we just haven't voiced this morning, but we bring our praise to you. Thank you, Lord God, for being our Saviour, Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Anna. And thank you, everybody, for being willing to contribute and to express what we are grateful for. It's good to actually give voice to that, or at least to communicate that to others. It's an encouragement. And today we are going up the mountain with Jesus. We're in Mark chapter 9, and we're heading up the mountain. I'm only going to read you the first verse from our reading today to get us started. It's verse 2 of chapter 9. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. And I wonder if for just a moment we can take that as a metaphorical mountain, a mountain top with Jesus. And when you're on a mountain top, you can look back and see the extraordinary climb that you have no idea how you managed to make. But there it is. You can look back and see the way you've come. You can see the foothills. You can see maybe where your car's parked. You can see back quite a long way. And in the company of Jesus, I would love for us to be able to look back. This week, Gareth sent his report as a secretary, just summing up in sort of general terms what we've done this year, what has happened in the life of the church this year. And I know that most of you will have read that. And I hope it will have been an encouragement, because although, gosh, what a year, none of us expected. And none of us, I think, had ever imagined that church could be like this. And yet this is what we have. And over this year, Gareth has reminded us in his report of how God has led us, how he's enabled us, how he has ministered to us, and in the church body, one to another, how we've ministered to each other. As Anna says, as Anna just mentioned about there being dips, there have been troughs and high points, and in all of it God has been faithful, but so has our understanding of church, that we have walked beside one another through this. And when one of us has been struggling, and I speak for myself here, when any of us have been struggling, there have been people within the church family who have been able to get alongside, even just virtually get alongside and walk with us and sustain us and support us and show God's love. So in the company of Jesus, where you are on this mountaintop looking back, I would love if you are able to just spend a moment now, in a moment of quiet, asking Jesus, ask the Spirit to show you as you look back, what is it you want to show me? What is there a highlight? Is there something you want to remind me of in the past year? It might be something that is very personal and not for sharing. It might be something that is in the life of the church that you've been really encouraged by. It might be something that God has been teaching you and you realize there has been a lesson that you've learned, or something that you have really grown into in this last year. It may actually be that the Holy Spirit wants to remind you or bring to mind painful memories, because this last year has contained a lot of distress for people, a lot of sadness and concerns and fears and worries. And that's part of our story over this last year too. And we hold all of that together. But in the company of Jesus at the top of the mountain, just in the silence for, it's only going to be 30 seconds or, you know, that sort of amount, ask Jesus to bring to mind, what is it you want to remind me of for this year? And then I'll take us on after that. So let's have a moment of quiet to ask that question. And now, there may be several things that have come to mind, the memories of this year. What we're going to do is invite you to join a small breakout room. It'll just be maybe two or three of you. It's the equivalent of me saying to you, turn to the person next to you and share and pray. Okay, so if you can imagine in your head that you're sitting in a church and told, turn to the person next to you, it's that sort of thing, okay? If it really... we really don't want to do this and be in a room with somebody else to share, then just stay in this main meeting. Don't join the breakout room. But please do, if you're staying in the main room instead of joining and talking to somebody else, please do pray about that. If something that Jesus pointed out to you is a positive thing, then please spend time just thanking God for that. If it's something that actually sits with you and it's a hard memory, a difficult one, then please just give that to God also. Be honest. Pray about that. Lament. Just share that with Jesus and perhaps ask further questions about that. If you do go into a breakout room, and I really hope that you will, please don't spend all your time chatting, but it'd be great if you could just share if there was a memory or something that's happened this year that you want to pray about. Do that briefly and then let's pray. There's only going to be 5 minutes, so please do share briefly and then get down to praying prayers of thanks or even, as I say, of lament, if that is what has been brought to mind. But let's be led by the Spirit and pray with one another as the body of Christ. So Gareth is going to put us into, or invite us to join a breakout room, and then we'll all come back together. So don't go away anywhere else. It always feels a bit of a risk sending you to another room and hoping that everybody will come back again and you won't use that as an excuse to slip out the back door. So thank you for returning. I realise it wasn't a massive amount of time to share and to pray, but hopefully you've been able to hear from one another, and it is good to hear what God's been up to from one another. But as I've mentioned before, lament is part of the church's repertoire of songs. If we look at the Psalms, a very large proportion of those Psalms are Psalms of bewilderment and confusion and of sadness, and sometimes of real questioning and anger about what has happened. And to be honest, although we meet each Sunday, and I feel that one of the great reasons we meet together is to renew our commitment to God, to have a fresh vision of him, to be encouraged to rely on him and to receive from him and to worship him, that's also held in tension with the fact that for many of us there are real sadnesses that we carry, even if that is simply the separation and having to live without being with those that we love. And for many other people, it is also, there are also sadnesses that are very acute, and events that have happened that are bewildering and are cause great hurt. And so we're going to have a chance now just to acknowledge that. It may be that there's nothing for you that springs to mind as a grievance or as a question or a sadness, and that's fine, just go with it. But for others of us, there may be things that we are carrying that we need to just be able to express honestly to God. And we'll do this privately. We won't be sharing this, but we will have, I'll read a psalm, and then we will listen to a song that's based on that psalm. Just to give you space, if you have those sort of songs of lament from within that you want to express, then I hope this will give you space to do that privately with God. The psalm is Psalm 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? And for us, our enemy might be fear. Our enemy might be anxiety. It might be job losses and worry about the future. Our enemy might be the coronavirus. Our enemy, we're told in the New Testament, is not flesh and blood, but the powers and principalities of darkness. How long? Look on me and answer, O Lord my God, give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. My enemy will say, ha, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love, and my heart rejoices in your salvation. And I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. Let's use this time as you need to be able to express to Father God what's on your heart as we hear those words of Psalm 13 in this song. So let's turn our prayers to those around us as we come to a time of intercession. Let's pray together. God of the past and of the future, we bring to you in prayer those people and places on our hearts today. We remember the parts of the world where people are being killed, oppressed, and displaced. We pray especially today for the people of the Yemen, for the people of Darfur in Sudan, for the Uyghur peoples in China, and for those caught up in the power struggles in Myanmar. May those in power leave behind violence and follow your call to peace. Lord Jesus, you called fishermen as they worked. So we pray for fishermen today as they struggle to make a living. We pray for all those who work to bring food to our table as they struggle with the complexities of legislation, of border controls, and the challenges of extreme weather. May those who exploit or abuse leave behind cruelty and greed and follow your call to compassion. We pray for all young people caught up in and trapped by gangs and the violence of that world. For those who live in fear of being attacked. For those who face uncertainty about the future, their education and their work prospects. For those struggling to reintegrate into school life once more. Lord, help them to leave behind despair and follow your call to hope. And finally, we pray for one another, for our church family, for our community, and our own loved ones. For those who feel overwhelmed by the challenges of each day. For those adapting to new ways of living. For those who are ill. For those close to death. And for those who are grieving. Help each of us to leave behind all that separates us from you and from one another, and to follow your call to trust and to love. In Jesus' name, we pray all these things. Amen. We have another song now, again reflecting on the journey that God has brought us on and his faithfulness through it all. Never once in these last 12 months, never once have we walked alone.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory is your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God. Battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone. Carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace. Never once, no, we never walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. Every step we are breathing in your grace. Evermore we'll be breathing out your praise. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful. You are faithful, God, you are faithful.
Yes, Lord, and all the looking back that we've done this morning and the remembering, we want to acknowledge and praise you for your faithfulness, for your unending, never changing, loving kindness towards us. That when we have walked through the fire, when we have walked through the flood, you have been with us. And you have led us through. And if for some of us we feel we are still on that journey through the flood, we place our trust in you, our Saviour, the one who holds our future in your hands and who will not let us be swept away. For we are safe in your hands. And we trust you, Lord, to lead us on. We trust you to hold on to us, to guide us, to keep us. And through the trials and the difficulties, to shape us, to teach us, to comfort and strengthen us, that we might become more like Jesus, for having understood what it is to pass through the struggle and the trial and the suffering, and to emerge in your presence. Knowing that we have a song of your faithfulness to sing. Lord, thank you for your faithfulness towards us, individually and as your church, your people. We praise you this morning. In the name of Jesus, the faithful one. Amen. I'd love to take us up that mountain, or if you're already there, wait for me to catch up. We're coming up the mountain and we're going to have a think, imagine what it was like for them, the disciples who traveled with Jesus on that trek up the mountain. So I'm going to read a few verses from chapter 9. The story is no doubt very familiar to you, but as you listen, I'll read slowly, as you listen, just imagine the scene. We've done this before. Imagine the scene, imagine the smells, the sounds, the sights. And then I'll take us through it again and just share a few thoughts that have come to me as I've been reflecting on this passage. But let's make ourselves comfortable and invite the Holy Spirit to use our imaginations to help us enter into this scene. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There, he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them. And a voice came from the cloud. "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked round, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. They kept the matter to themselves, discussing what rising from the dead meant. And that's where we leave the disciples for the moment, still trying to puzzle out what Jesus means when he talks about death and rising from the dead. It's a puzzle to them. For us, we're probably sort of shouting into the scripture saying, "Come on, you must get it. We understand it, but we're on this side of Easter." And they still hadn't really understood what was going on or what was about to happen. But do you notice, when I read through this, I was struck by the intimacy of this, because we get blown away by the image of Jesus being transfigured and all shining brightly, and it's sort of like heaven touching earth, and we get blown away by that image and forget that actually this description of what happened on the day is quite intimate. They were there up the mountain alone with Jesus. All alone. Getting alone with Jesus would have been a real privilege, don't you think? After traveling with crowds and crowds all the time, even that time when Jesus said to his disciples, who were clearly exhausted, "Come away with me and get some rest." What happened? The crowds came anyway, and he turned around and started ministering and indeed feeding them. But here he takes James and John and Peter. He takes them a long way, a long climb up a mountain, so that they can be all alone with Jesus. Where do you manage this? How do you manage in your life to get alone with Jesus? It is a challenge, and depending on your season of life, it may be a very great challenge. I remember when the children were very small, when they were tiny and sleeping lots, it might have been a bit easier, but as soon as they start making their presence felt, you feel like the day is not your own. Getting alone with Jesus becomes incredibly difficult. And perhaps those 2 minutes locked in a bathroom several times a day are your getting alone with Jesus time for where you are in your season of life. For others, there is more flexibility, but it still needs to be intentional. There's a mountain to climb for some of us to be alone, all alone with Jesus. And some of us perhaps give up climbing the mountain because it just seems too hard. But where do you manage to get all alone with Jesus? Is it out for your walk? Is it in the early morning or late at night when the rest of the house is quiet? Is there a particular chair that you have, a particular room that you have where you go regularly to be with Jesus? God longs to spend time with us. Probably his desire to be with us far outweighs our own desire to be with him, if we're honest. But he longs to be with us. And so just turning up, just committing to being in that place, to setting aside that time, whatever that mountain is you have to climb, that intention to get alone with Jesus, just showing up is half the battle, because God is already waiting for you to meet with you. And it may not be a mountaintop transfiguration style experience every time you show up and meet with Jesus. But if you don't show up and get alone with Jesus, then you won't have the chance of that encounter, whatever it looks like. So my question to myself as well as to you is, where do you go to get alone with Jesus? So we have this transfiguration, this vision of Jesus. The disciples are seeing Jesus in a completely new light, quite literally, in a new way. He's shining. His clothes are bright white, whiter than any dazzle or bold product can make it. Bright white, so much so that perhaps you couldn't look full in the face. You couldn't open your eyes to see. And certainly it was a quite an awe-inspiring moment. And our vision of Jesus, does it have space in it, the way you see Jesus? Does it have room in it for being absolutely blown away by his presence? Or is he domesticated? Is he your savior in your pocket for when you need him, but quite easily managed at other times when you don't? Is there space in your vision of Jesus for him to be that incredible, awe-inspiring, fear-inducing presence? If you remember Lucy Pevensey in The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe, hearing about Aslan the lion and being quite frightened at the idea, and then understanding that the animals met with this lion and didn't seem to be quite so fearful. So she asks the beaver, well, is Aslan tame then? And the beaver says, oh, he's not tame, but he's good. He's good. Our Lord is not tame. The Lion of Judah is not tame. But he is good. I wonder if we have a vision of Jesus that's big enough to include this awe-inspiring, this face on the ground, fearful worship of the one who is, who was and is to come. If you need inspiration, read chapters 4 and 5 of Revelation, just to get that other perspective, to see the risen Jesus and to be inspired to worship him. And there he is. He shows up on the mountaintop with Moses and Elijah. And there's loads of symbolism in there. There's a whole series of sermons you can have on that. But he's there in very illustrious company, and they're chatting. They're talking together. There's a fulfillment there of his role as a continuation and a fulfillment of the Old Testament, his role as prophet and lawgiver and law liberator. And there's loads of stuff in that. If you want to ponder that trilogy, those three people on the top of the mountain, Moses, Elijah and Jesus, that was the red carpet moment for the disciples, seeing all those heroes. Well, those two heroes of old that they knew about, and their Jesus, their rabbi, their teacher, talking with these amazing figures from history. That helped them, I think, to understand Jesus in a new light and deepen their respect for him. And then Peter, bless him, the external processor, the one who needs to talk to think and doesn't think before he talks. And he's just blown away by this. And his natural response is to capture the moment. I mean, let's face it, that's so true of our age, with all of the photographs that happen. Every moment is captured and archived and put on Facebook, and we like to capture moments because we don't want them to disappear. We want to remember them. And for Peter, this meant putting up booths, like shelters, that would be monuments. I'm not sure if they were supposed to be shelters or tents to capture and keep those people, or to provide a memorial that he should not forget, that they should venerate this moment and these people. He wants to do something to capture this moment and not let it go. but it seems that that's not God's plan. Not at that moment. God is moving on. There's a dynamic movement rather than a memorialization of what's happening there. And then comes the cloud, the classic theophany, the classic sort of representation of God's presence, like in the desert, remember, leading as a pillar of cloud. The cloud descends and a voice speaks. And the voice that speaks is the same voice that spoke at Jesus' baptism. And the words that he says are very similar. This is my son. I love him. Or I'm well pleased with him, depending on the translation. But this is my son. There should be no doubt about who Jesus is. The voice of God has said, this is my son. But this time, at the top of the mountain, there's an instruction as well. And church, I want us to hear that instruction. This is my son whom I love. Listen to him. Listen to him. The next words of Jesus to the disciples are presumably, well, they're not quoted, but they are described, that they are to keep this whole experience a secret, keep perhaps Jesus' place in history, his identity, his glory, a secret until he should rise from the dead again. After which, presumably, they're to tell the world. And if you read in at the end of Matthew's gospel, you'll know that's exactly what Jesus says. Go into all the world and tell them. For the moment, they're to be quiet and keep it secret until he rises from the dead. Listen to him, the Lord says. He is the head of the church. I am not the head of Chudley Baptist Church. The leadership team is not the head of Chudley Baptist Church. Jesus is the head of Chudley Baptist Church, of every church that bears his name. He is the head. Listen to him. I don't know how you manage to do that individually. The getting alone with Jesus is part of that. The reading his word, reading the red letter words, you know, the Bibles that have the words of Jesus in red, so we can more easily home in on his words. Listen to him. How are you going to do that this year? How are you going to prioritize listening to the one who has the words of eternal life? And as a church, as we emerge gradually from this state of being into something different again, we need to listen to Jesus, who is the head of the church. Boris Johnson has a roadmap, a provisional roadmap for the nation to get out of lockdown. I want to know what God's roadmap is for Chudley Baptist Church. And I'm not going to learn that in its entirety by listening to politicians. We're going to learn that by listening to Jesus, the head of the church. And it might be that what God's roadmap for us is, where as we emerge from this lockdown and this all of these restrictions, it might not simply be a going back to what was normal before. What if God has something new? Something that he's taught us through this time that we are to carry forwards as we come down from the mountain and move on with Jesus. There surely are things that are different now that weren't the case before. God is doing perhaps a new thing, and we're only going to know that by listening to him. How are we to engage in God's mission to Chudley, to the people of our community? We'll know that by listening to Jesus. Listen to him. As a church, we're going to be trying to do that very intentionally. So I would encourage you individually to be getting alone with Jesus, to be listening, and then to be sharing as a church, so that together we can hear from one another, we can hear what Christ is saying to his church. But let's be a church that is predominantly listeners. So we are then acting and speaking from what we see and hear God doing, rather than out of our own best intentions and best efforts. Those are the words that struck me as I read this passage. Simply this: this is my son whom I love. Listen to him. I pray that you find time to do that in your own life, and that as a church we move forward as people of God who are listening to Jesus above and beyond anything else. Amen. We do anticipate that God has more for us. We have 2020 behind us. We don't know what 2021 is going to look like. Hopefully it won't be a repeat of 2020. What we've learned is that God is faithful throughout. Whatever 2021 brings, God is going to be faithful again. And we are trusting him for great things, for new things, for growth, for seeing new people come to hear the message of the good news of salvation. We are trusting him for new people to join our church. We're trusting him for the church to rise up, discover and use our gifts to build one another up, to spur each other on, to reach out and bless our communities. We're trusting God for all of that. And we're listening for how we're meant to do that. But we are looking to him, the one who has done great things and who will do greater things yet. So let's use this final song as we reflect on perhaps where God is leading us and how we're going to trust him to do those great things in our lives.
Hey.
But let's hear these words as we sort of end our time of worship together. By your Spirit, help us to grow more in the likeness of Christ, bearing his light as we seek to serve you in the church and the world. Amen.